It is a delight to be with you this morning, and we're excited about beginning the revival here at Putnamville Baptist Church. I thank the Lord for the years that we have had opportunity to come and be with these fine folks, and I want to thank Brother Rick Brown for still having a desire and an emphasis on the preaching of the Word of God, seeing the need for revival. And I just so much appreciate his friendship. And then all the folks here at Putnamville, I tell you, just love you so very, very much. And we're glad to have the privilege to come into your home. A little unusual in the fact that we're not meeting at the physical side of the church this morning. But we thrill for the privilege and the opportunity to be able to come into your homes. And if you would, I'd like for you to go ahead and gather the family around. We're excited. Let's continue to be faithful to come and set aside this time just as if we were going to church. And let's not lose the habit of gathering together as a family around the truth of the Word of God. And then also, I'd like to thank Brother David Powers and the Emmanuel Baptist Church here in Kingsport for taking the time and opening up the auditorium and the facilities that we could come and do the revival in a church setting. And we're excited about that, and we so much appreciate them and the testimony they have in the community. And we just thank them so very, very much. But I want to begin, as we think about this revival service, the Lord has laid a thought upon my heart that I want to deal with this morning. And I'd like for you to go ahead and open your Bibles, if you will, to the book of Matthew, chapter number 15. In just a moment, we're going to begin reading in verse number 21. And I don't know exactly, it was maybe about a week ago, something like that. I was riding along in my truck, and I had made it a sort of a habit at times to have the entire Bible on cassette tape and also on CD. And I put it in. I listen to it when I'm riding along. And I was listening to Graham Scrogg. Yes, he was reading through the book of Matthew. And as he was reading through chapter number 15, it was immediately the Lord Jesus Christ, the Holy Spirit of God, began to speak to my heart out of this particular passage, and out of it has grown the thought that I want to magnify in your hearing this morning. What I'd like to preach from, or the thought this morning for just a little while, is on the idea of great is thy faith. Great is thy faith. Now, notice, if you will, in Matthew chapter number 15, and I want to begin reading in verse number 21, and I'll read down to verse number 28, and then have just a word of prayer, and bring to you the thought that is upon my heart this morning. Notice here the Bible said, verse 21, and then Jesus went thence and departed into the coast of Tyre and Sidon. And behold, a woman of Canaan came out of the same coast, and cried unto him, saying, Have mercy on me, O Lord, thy son of David. My daughter is grievously vexed with the devil. But he answered her not a word. And his disciples came and besought him, saying, Send her away, for she crieth after us. But he answered and said, I am not sent but unto the lost sheep of the house of Israel. Then came she and worshipped him, saying, Lord, help me. But he answered and said, It is not meet to take the children's bread and to cast it to dogs. And she said, Truth, Lord, yea, the dogs eat of the crumbs which fall from their master's table. Then Jesus answered and said unto her, Now notice this, O woman, great is thy faith. I bid unto thee even as thou wilt, and her daughter was made whole from that very hour. Let's pray. Our gracious and most kind Heavenly Father, we thank you, Lord, for this truth that you have allowed us to see from the Word of God. And Lord, I pray this morning as I endeavor to preach this truth, Lord, may you empower me with the Spirit of God. Lord, may you make it possible that I can deliver it in such a manner that it is with a power and an unction that you have moved it upon my own heart. And Lord, I pray that you would give us ears to hear, receive all the glory, all the honor, and we'll love you and praise you for all that you're doing. For we ask it in Jesus' precious name we pray. Amen and amen. I want to draw your attention again over there in the verse of Scripture where in verse number 28, the Lord Jesus Christ answered and said to her, O woman, great is thy faith. In other words, here this woman is, and she ultimately ends up getting what she needs, getting what she asked the Lord for. Now, I think sometimes when in my own heart as I was looking at this passage, I've read this passage, and I think there has been occasions that I've actually preached out of this passage. But the other day, when, as I said, I was listening to Brother Scrobby read this passage, it was almost as if it became or came alive afresh and anew. And I begin to realize that to some degree, we miss the profound impact that Jesus is making about this woman's faith. I will acknowledge that she has faith. But I believe we really miss the impact of what he's saying about great is thy faith. And as I begin to look, begin to read and study, I begin to realize that the magnitude of this statement that Jesus is making, the best way to see the magnitude of it is to contrast the two parties that are there in this setting. And you say, what do you mean, Brother Bob? Well, notice, if you will, in verse number 23, if you will. I notice that there is his disciples. In other words, there are these individuals that we know 12 chosen men by him that are to be with him for 3.5 years. And may I say, they're one of the parties that are there. Then also notice, if you will, the Bible said in verse number 22 that a woman of Canaan came out of the same coast. In other words, we have our Lord, but the two parties that are there within this particular event are the Lord's disciples and this woman himself. And so as I begin to think about them and these two parties, I begin to try to contrast what Jesus has said about their faith in some particular instance. Now, notice, if you will, and you don't need to turn for the sake of time, but trust my reading. But I want to read something about the faith of the disciples. It's found in Matthew chapter number 8 and verse number 25 and verse number 26. And we find that Jesus is in a ship with the disciples, and they're making their way across the Sea of Galilee. And this severe storm comes up. And notice, if you will, verse number 25. And his disciples came to him and woke him, saying, Lord, save us, we perish. Now, this is what Jesus said in verse number 26. And he said unto them, why are ye afraid, O ye of little faith? Then he arose and rebuked the wind and the sea, and there was a great calm. I noticed there, here his disciples, this wind is transpiring. And all of a sudden, there's this fear, there's this anxiety. They wake him up, they question his love and his care for them. And he makes this comment, there in the verse, O ye of little faith. Now, when you study that term out, that little word, little faith, it means skeptical. It means to lack confidence in Christ. It comes from the word, literally, a puny possession. Now think about what Jesus just come through saying. As he talks about these men's faith, these 12 men chosen of him, these 12 men that will walk with him and fellowship him, with him, that will see miracles, that will hear his word day in and day out, literally says, this woman. Here is an individual, a woman that lives outside of the borders of the nation of Israel. She is a Gentile woman, and Jesus says of her, "Oh woman, great is thy faith." That word great there means great, exceeding, mighty, or strong. In other words, when we begin to contrast of the disciples and contrast of this woman of Canaan, one has puny faith and one has great and mighty faith. Now I wonder, you know, as I thought about that, I wonder which one that we would want the Lord to contrast us with. I wonder which one of those two aspects of faith would we want Him to say, we've got little faith or we've got great faith. I wonder, may I say, I believe with all my heart that the answer to that question is there's not one person that's listening this morning that would ever want Jesus to describe their faith as little. Every one of us would want Jesus to say that our faith is a great faith. As I begin to think about this woman, and I begin to think about this idea of having great faith, and may I say this morning, that's the desire of my heart. I want to not only the Lord to know, but may I say, I would like to be known as an individual of faith. Thank God Abraham was known as a man of faith. May I say there's individuals throughout the Word of God that they are known for their faith. And I'd like to be known not only from the Lord, but I'd like to be known from individuals around that they have confidence of coming and asking me to pray, a confidence in my life, knowing that I'm an individual. But as I thought about that, the question became obvious. Well, how do you have great faith? What are the elements that make a great faith? In other words, here the Lord is. There must be something. There must be something there within this woman's life in the way that she's acting that Jesus would acknowledge. Here's some elements of great faith. Now I know that throughout the entire Word of God, no doubt, there are many elements that we can see that would reveal great faith. But this morning, as we begin this revival, I want us to zero in. I want us to maintain here within the text. And I want us to see three elements that I believe that reveal, that help this woman to have what we know and what Jesus declared is great, strong, and mighty faith in Him. Notice, if you will, in verse number 22 and verse number 23. I notice, first of all, that there is a steadfast supplication. A steadfast supplication. Notice in verse 22, the Bible said, and cried unto Him. In verse number 23, the Bible said, and she cried after us. In other words, when Jesus here, He reaches the shore and He comes out, and all of a sudden this woman makes her way out of the same coast there, and the Bible said, and cried unto Him. That word cried there carries the idea. It's more than just to speak to. It's more than just to elevate to some extent out of the voice and in the level of speaking. But the word cry there literally means to croak as a raven, to scream, and to call out, to shriek, to exclaim, or entreat. May I say, like a raven, she's shrieking and making known her request. I don't know about you, but I thank the Lord for the privilege and the opportunity that I had to get out in nature and be around out in nature. And may I say, if you've ever been around where maybe some crows were or some ravens were, may I say, one of the most eerie, most alarming sounds is to hear maybe is there fighting a hawk or fighting an owl or fighting something, and there's this constant croaking, this constant screaming, this constant loud noise that they're making. It's almost unnerving at times. And here this woman is. She falls in behind the Lord Jesus Christ. And there's this constant alarm, this constant shriek, this constant entreating. But notice something here. Notice while we see the strength and the sternness of our application with Jesus, notice that this practice does not stop just with Jesus. Notice what happens down in verse 23. Notice that evidently she not only has followed Jesus, but notice in the Word of God, she begins to follow the disciples. And she continues over and over. The Bible says there, she crieth after us. In other words, she begins to become so repetitive that finally the disciples, it's not just her that's making requests. Now it's the disciples making requests. Notice what she says, or what he says. They say. They say, send her away. I love that little phrase there. It means to free fully. To relieve, release, dismiss. To let die, pardon, or set at liberty. To send away or put away. In other words, all the disciples, here they are. They've heard all they want to hear of this request. And they finally say, Lord, you're going to have to do something. Either heal her or run her off, one of the two. See, we not only see the magnitude of the strength and the sternness, but notice we see the repetitiveness of her cry, of her steadfastness in supplication. You don't have to turn, but if you will, trust my reading a verse of Scripture you're very, very familiar with. But in Matthew chapter number 7, in verse number 7, the Bible said Jesus is speaking. And he said, ask and it shall be given. Seek and ye shall find. Knock and it shall be opened unto you. For everyone that asketh receiveth. And he that seeketh findeth. And to him that knocketh, it shall be opened unto him. You that have studied the Word of God, familiar with the Word of God, know that these words that Jesus used, ask, seek, and knock, are ideas of repetitive terms. The idea does not mean that you just knock or ask or seek one time. But the idea is ask and keep on asking. Knock and keep on knocking. Seek and keep on seeking. And the idea is there's a persistence that is being made. May I say, as you think about this woman in Matthew chapter 15, may I say, you see this persistence. You see this individual that will not be denied. There's this continual following of Christ, this continual following of the disciples. And she shrieks and cries out aloud her need from God. You don't need to turn, but I'll just sort of paraphrase. I'll not take time to read it all. But over in chapter number 18 of the book of Luke, there the Lord Jesus Christ delivers a parable. And let me give you the purpose of the parable. And he spake a parable unto them to this end, that men ought to always pray. Listen to this. And not to faint. Talk about an unjust judge. There was a woman in a widow there in the town, and she would come to this unjust judge and make her request known. But finally, the Bible says there it wasn't because he wanted to answer her, but he said because of her importunity, because she'll not stop, I will avenge her of her adversary. You say, what's your point, Brother Bob? I say, the Lord wants us to understand when it comes to this idea of supplication, it must be steadfast. There must be this continual coming and bringing our petition to the Lord. May I say, when we look here in Luke chapter number 15, and we think about this great faith, may I say, the first element that is revealed in great faith, it is marked by a steadfast supplication. But then notice, secondly, if you will, in verse number 27 of our text, not only is it marked by a steadfast supplication, but notice that there is a subordinate state. There is a subordinate state. Notice the woman makes this comment in verse 27. Truth, Lord, yea, the dogs eat the crumbs which fall from the master's table. She's just finished making her request up in the previous verses. And the Lord turns and responds to her request. And Jesus says, it's not meet to take the children's bread and to cast it to the dogs. Now, I want you to notice within this response, within this story here, that there are two things that this woman is making no attempt to identify with. She's not trying to elevate herself, but she's not trying to get into a particular position in which there is a something that makes God do what she wants Him to do. Notice, first of all, she is making no attempt to identify with the heir. See, the heir is a rightful one that deserves or has rights to certain things. Notice that word, children. He said it's not right or not meet to give the children's bread. That word children has the idea of a child produced by birth or the offspring of a mother or the offspring of a family. In other words, the bread that was there was rightfully theirs. They had every right to eat of it. They had every right to partake of it. They had every right to possess it. You say, why, Brother Bob? They're an heir. The fact of the matter is, as heirs, there are certain rights, there are certain aspects, there are certain things that you have the right to possess. And when this woman comes, she says, I'm not trying to put myself in the position of an heir. I'm not trying to elevate myself out of this thing that I deserve or I earn what or I'm entitled to what I'm asking for. Then notice, secondly, not only is she making no attempt to identify with the heir, but may I say, she's making no attempt to identify with the home. Notice he says, cast it to the dogs. That word dog there, when translators look it up in the concordance, it means puppy dog. And if you'll notice there within the text, that it points out that it's falling from the master's table. You say, what do you mean, Brother Bob? In other words, this puppy dog, evidently, what the Lord is alluding to is this is the companion in the home. This is the pet that belongs to the family. In other words, the idea is that this bread belongs to the heir. This bread belongs in the home. Or they have a right for the puppy dog or the pet of the home to have it. She doesn't even identify with the pet at home. Notice her words she uses when she says more than dogs. The idea is means that mongrel dog that walks the streets, the scavenger in the streets of Jerusalem. In other words, she's saying, what I'm coming for, I do not merit. What I'm coming for, I have no legal right to. What I'm asking for is mercy. I'm not asking for mercy. I'm not trying to elevate myself to some position in which you only or I'm entitled to. But I ask that you would stoop in kindness and favor to someone undeserving and give that which I need in the healing of my daughter. See, great faith not only has the aspect of taking a subordinate state, has the aspect of also being one that is steadfast in supplication. But notice, if you will, thirdly, in this idea of great faith, there is a sufficient sovereign. There is a sufficient sovereign. Notice in verse 27, she says, truth, Lord, yea, the dogs eat the crumbs which fall from the master's table. Now, I want to make again this distinction between the faith of the disciples and the faith of this woman. When the disciples were out there on that sea and the storm arose, may I say they expressed no confidence whatsoever in the Lord Jesus Christ. As I said, it represents the idea when he said, little, a puny in possession, puny in in the idea of belief. In other words, they're totally critical, and they lack even confidence that God is able to do anything in their body. But may I say, when he talks about this great faith, may I say this woman is not coming to him with any area, any aspect of the idea that God is not capable. But may I say, when she comes to the Lord Jesus Christ, she knows that he is more than sufficient to meet his need. There's no lack of faith. There's no lack of confidence. There's no lack in any aspect that Jesus cannot do. You say, how do you know that? How do you magnify this truth? It's magnified in what she asked for. Notice, if you will, there's two things I want you to see. Notice, first of all, notice the contrast between bread versus crumbs. You need to understand in the text, she's not asking for bread. She doesn't even make an implication that she wants bread. She's making a request for crumbs. See, the word bread there means bread is raised, or the implication of a loaf. She's saying, Lord, when I come to you, I know you have sufficient ability. And Lord, what I'm wanting from you, what I'm desiring from you, is not a full loaf. It's not even a part of a loaf. Lord, I would settle for the crumbs. That word crumbs means little bit, and I love this. It comes from a word meaning to rub or touch the surface of. Think just for a moment. I don't know if this impacts you like it thrills my heart. But you know what this woman is saying? Her faith is so big. Her faith is so great. She said, if I could come to the sufficiency of God and just simply take my hand and rub the top of his sufficiency, it would be enough to take care of my daughter's. Just what would occur from simply rubbing off the surface of the sufficiency of God himself would meet my need. I wonder, do you have a faith like that? Do you have faith in a God that has such great ability that even just the superficial areas of what you can gain by rubbing the top of his power would be enough to meet your need? But then notice, not only is there the contrast of bread to crumbs, but there's the contrast between cast and fall. Notice he said there in the verse, he said, it's not meat to cast. That idea there, the word cast, means to throw with intent. To throw down or thrust down. And notice who it would be that would cast it down. It would be a willful act of the owner. A willful act of those that were part of the family. They possessed, they owned. It was theirs. And she's saying here, this willful act of the owner to cast it down. That's not what I'm asking for. But notice when she made reference to the crumbs, that which is given from just rubbing the top or the surface, she said, they fall. In other words, it's not an intended act. It's not. In other words, the idea is you've been around where it's at. You've been privileged around whereby, as you were eating maybe a Thanksgiving meal or something, and someone had went to the trouble of making homemade bread or rolls or whatever, and then they come hot and you're ready to put them, and you begin to break or you begin to harden or whatever it is, and you look down and there's crumbs. There was no intent to make those crumbs, but they came in the action of breaking the bread. She's saying, Lord, in your act of breaking the bread and meeting others' needs, just what would fall from your sufficiency? of my life would be sufficient enough to meet the needs of my daughter. Lord, your sufficiency, your power, He is enough to move and act and touch and help in the need of just what would flutter down from your activities of working in others would be enough to meet the needs of my daughter. See, great faith is marked by a sufficient Savior. Great faith is marked by not only a sufficient Savior, but a steadfast supplication. And it's marked by a subordinate state. See, as this woman comes and begins to make her request, she comes and exhibits one of a lowly position at the feet of one who's sufficiently sovereign. And in compassion, asks that he might speak and he might act in her behalf. And Jesus looked at her and looked at his disciples. And realizing this woman, this Canaanite woman, he says unto her, "Great, strong, mighty is thy faith. Be it according to thee." You know, I'm glad that we have a God that is sufficient to meet our needs. This morning, I hope that as we think about our own faith, I hope that we can have a desire, we can want to experience and want to exhibit a great faith in a great God. But I must admit, many times in my own life, I'm afraid I identify more with the disciples than I do with this woman of Canaan. I find myself that the Lord would have to say, "Puny, little, Bob, little is your faith." May you and I desire this morning to elevate our faith life. Because there's one thing for sure. He has the ability, he has the strength, he has the sufficiency to do abundantly above all that we could ever ask or think. Let us be individuals of great faith. Let's pray. Our gracious and most kind Heavenly Father, we thank you for the privilege and the honor to be able to start this revival meeting. Lord, I thank you for those that have taken the time to gather around and purposely gather family and friends for this service. Lord, I pray that this would continue not only this morning, but this afternoon and Monday night, Tuesday night, Wednesday night. Lord, as we endeavor to have revival, that you might meet with us and speak to our hearts. And Lord, even as the thought this morning, Lord, would you be kind enough to help us to be men and women of great faith? Lord, as I think about that, I thought about the man where he brought his son and asked Jesus to help him. And he said, Lord, heal my son. And the Lord says, "It's possible for all. If thou hast faith thou canst believe, all things are possible." And he said, "Lord, help thou my unbelief." In other words, grow my faith. Lord, I pray that'll be our prayer. If we see an area in our lives that there's an absence, there's a lack, Lord, I pray for everyone that's listening this morning, Lord, would you grow our faith, that we might be people with great, strong, and mighty faith, like this woman here. And we'll love you and thank you and praise you, for we ask it. In Jesus' precious name we pray. Amen and amen.